Okay, very good morning. And this is like, you know, the night watchman continuing. Yesterday I was a replacement. And I was told at the last minute that I have to speak. And then again in the morning, I was told that Anil Devli, who is the CEO of INSA, is unable to make it for some reasons. And therefore, they said, will you step up? I said, I am not sure whether I am capable of. But yes, certainly there are certain developments which I am sure many of you, because the people that I see now in this audience are mostly the learned people who probably know little about shipping. So it will be unfair on my part to say that what is shipping, etc., etc. But we will, between me and Captain Nafde, who is a doyen of shipping industry, who was a nautical advisor to Government of India at one point of time, we will try and probably give you a little flavor of what is going to come in future. And I think therefore the title Shaping the Shipping is apt in that sense. Yes, Commodore Mukherjee, I would request your indulgence whenever you think we are going wrong, because you have been there again helping the shipbuilders, ship repairers, and so on and so forth for last many years, many decades rather. So please, anybody in the audience who feels that we need to make some course correction, please do that. Yesterday, Admiral Dhowan mentioned that while we have close to 1,500 million metric tons of cargo, which we expect to double as we move from a $3 trillion to a $5 trillion and then to $10 trillion economy, the cargo is likely to be doubled, and the figures and the numbers that we are talking of are purely the exim trade. We haven't done a very, very serious and I must say a detailed study of how and what it will translate into in terms of ton kilometer cargo when we see the inland waterways actually flourishing and a very busy inland and coastal cargo movement starts in this country. At the same time, he also mentioned that the Indian bottoms carry only 7% of this total cargo that the country is today handling. Of the 15 million metric tons, the Indian bottoms carry only 7%. Rest all is carried by the foreign bottoms. And that is a significant cost. Yes, we understand and appreciate that this is a global industry. Therefore, whosoever is competitive will get the business. But having said that, there is a strategic importance of having our own ships carrying our own cargo. We all know that shipping is second line of defense. We very well know how important and critical it was during the Gulf War that we had our own tankers so that the energy supplies were uninterrupted. We also know the fact that Chabahar is a strategic initiative. It is not just a commercial initiative. So if all those things have to really fructify, then ship owning is also equally important. It's not just having the cargo, but ship owning is also equally important. Also, let's not forget the fact that these foreign ship owners operating or carrying Indian cargo present their balance sheets wherever they are registered. So from the point of view of revenue and the other aspects. Also, it is important that we have our own ships, or we have ships which are not just registered in India but owned by Indian ship owners. Towards this, there are some initiatives that the government has taken, relaxation of cabotage or allowing the Indian ship owners to own ship anywhere so that they file their returns here. So whatever profits they make anywhere in the world are accounted for here in this country, etc., etc. All of that is in place now. We also provided for what is known as tonnage tax regime, which was another important lacuna in our shipping sector, that the shipping industry was taxed as a corporate entity and therefore was making it unviable. But with the tonnage tax regime, we've given some concession, some relaxation to the ship owners on one hand, but on the other hand, unfortunately, as somebody, as our Admiral mentioned yesterday, that in government there are various departments and agencies which at times are at loggerheads. So on one hand, when the shipping ministry, in consultation with the finance ministry, was giving or is giving tonnage tax regime, at the same time, other services that the shipping companies either procure or provide are taxed separately, including the fuel surcharge, etc., etc., and what is called as a deemed service procurement. So even if you do your ship repair abroad, it is treated as deemed ship repair activity carried out in India, and therefore it is taxed. So there are another 13 different taxes which actually, in a way, offset the advantage that the shipping industry gets as under the tonnage tax regime. Currently, efforts are on to streamline this. Some of those have been taken away, but still the present tonnage tax regime, therefore, is not very attractive. This is a fact. And therefore, those who opted for it initially, thinking that this is going to be very interesting, because you know, practically it brings down the tax for a shipping company to something like 6 to 7%. I mean, if it is applied in toto and in true spirit, but that has not happened because of the various other 13 taxes that are applicable. And therefore, some of those who initially opted for a tonnage tax regime have also moved out and flagged their ships abroad so that they continue to get the benefit. So this is on the taxation side, where we need to really find a solution. How do we make Indian ships more friendly, tax friendly, and their businesses become more viable? Similar is the case of people who are on coastal shipping or inland waterways. We have the other modes of transport, be it road or rail, where the fuel that they consume is subsidized to an extent, definitely for railways and even for the state transport buses. But shipping does not enjoy this. Shipping does not have that kind of benefit, and it is not seen as a mass transport system because these benefits are granted to railway and the state transport corporations through the provision that these are treated as mass transport systems. But shipping is unfortunately still not considered as a mass transport system, and therefore there are charges levied on the fuel. Consider two scenarios where you have a foreign ship owner who is calling two ports in India, say from Kandla he is coming to Mumbai and then he's going back. He has picked up bunkers in Fujairah before calling at Kandla. Then he comes to Mumbai and then returns to Jebel Ali or Dubai or wherever. His fuel charges, I mean the fuel that he consumes is very, very cheap. But if there is a ship which is owned by an Indian ship owner and is doing a voyage from Kandla to Mumbai, and he picks up the bunkers at Kandla or at Mumbai, his bunkers are costly. Okay. So therefore, obviously, the trade opts for this ship, which is owned by a foreign shipping line or foreign owners, and puts the cargo there. And therefore, the Indian ship owner is at a disadvantage. Some of the states have given relaxation there, wherein they've either removed or brought down the VAT and other related taxes, pre-GST I'm talking about. But that is still not really helping. Then the bunkering terminals are not available. When we are talking of shipping, I think all these services or the ancillary services that are integral part of shipping industry are also equally important. The bunkering terminals are not available, the fuel is not available. And the interesting part is Bharat Petroleum has got a tie-up with a Singaporean company. And the bunker that this joint venture supplies in Singapore is actually a Bharat Petroleum product. Okay, so Bharat Petroleum exports this bunker, which is quality bunker, exports this bunker to Singapore, and this joint venture sells this bunker in Singapore, but Bharat Petroleum finds it difficult to find customers here in India because of the taxes. So all the ships which are, foreign ships which are calling here in India, although they buy bunkers from this joint venture of Bharat Petroleum in Singapore, they don't pick up bunkers here from same Bharat Petroleum, same refinery, same product here in Mumbai or in India. So these are some of the things I think, I mean, yesterday I sounded a little funny when I said Delhi is about more than 1,000 kilometers away from the coastline. These are the realities. These are the difficulties that the people there don't understand that this is actually what the shipping industry wants. If you make it cheaper, obviously it will become cheaper for the end user, customer. So you don't have to really give the subsidies that you are talking about. I mean, the government is saying that we will give subsidies to the user, to the consumer. The person who is actually putting or giving cargo, that is fine. That is part of promoting the sector as such or the mode of transport. But when you make the entrepreneur in the sector or the businessman who is actually a service provider, make him more economically stronger and viable, I think he doesn't require any support. He is not going to ask for any subsidy. And then he'll be in a position to actually market this service. Today it is the other way around. The ship owner is ready, the service provider is ready, but there are no takers for the service. I mean, again, the examples can be of different sectors within shipping. You had this a cruise that Damania that was operating between Mumbai and Goa, I think good 15 years ago. We all said that, you know, Parvez Damania is probably ahead of times. Because at that point of time, nobody visualized that something like this can come. And therefore, every single officer was thinking that this is a huge luxury. And therefore, this needs to be taxed heavily. No concessions to be given. No support to be provided. Everybody taking this cruise is going to be, you know, five-star, full of cash. And therefore, why should we give him that kind of a support? And then the whole thing collapsed. Of course, there were many other issues also. Customs Act, which again had this problem that they never appreciated that this cruise is an entertainment sector and industry. Therefore, there are certain inherent requirements of that category. And that was not permitted, so you go 12 nautical miles before you start any activity. So, I mean, anybody who's going on a cruise for 8 to 10 hours, say, from Mumbai to Goa, and for half of the time, I mean, 4 hours, if he's not going to get the real fun of it, it doesn't work. And that is where probably, you know, even that Damania fell apart. So these are some of the challenges that the shipping industry is actually facing. As I said, lobby is not very strong. Yesterday somebody mentioned that there are strong lobbies, road sector, etc. Yes, the shipping unheard. There is very little attention that is given. Also, I'm aware of the fact that there is, again, in shipping, there are two verticals, I would say. One vertical which is led by Navy. Okay, so Navy has its own way of looking at it, which we all agree and accept that they look at it from a different standpoint. But the commercial shipping, I mean the merchant shipping, requires certain advantages or freedom, which at times Navy objects to. Navy says, no, this is something that cannot be given because it is not in the national interest or there's a security threat, and et cetera, et cetera. But of late, I must say that there is greater dialogue, exchange, interaction. Otherwise, I've been in this sector for a little while, I think 2001 onwards, but then hardly we used to see the men in uniform attending the merchant shipping related or logistics related events, and vice versa. Of course, we the merchant shipping or the private logistics people hardly get to attend the naval workshops, etc. But with National Maritime Foundation taking up various issues which are not in the normal domain of strategic naval initiatives, I think there is a lot of interaction that is happening, and that is helping big way. Some of the other things which really are of crucial importance for shipping are the manpower. Manpower and related challenges that we have. Shipbuilding, yesterday we talked, we discussed in Sagarmala, so I'm not going to touch that, and we have Commander Mukherjee, who can probably speak even more eloquently on that. But yes, manpower. We have opened the training of seafarers for public private sector. And then we have the situation today wherein for one single job on board, we get at least 20 applications. That is the situation. As of now, today, we have 2,08,000 seafarers on board various ships across the globe. This again is something which the exact number was finalized, I would say, only about 6 months ago, when we had this e-migrant system that was introduced by DG Shipping in consultation with Immigration Department. Till then, we used to talk whether we have 1,50,000, we have 1,60,000. We had no idea how many seafarers we are actually sending. But now we know that because the various initiatives have been taken, the institutes have been rated. There are about 180 institutions in the country offering various courses for merchant shipping. These institutes are now rated by third-party agency. Their data is available in public domain on the DGCT shipping website. How many candidates admitted? How many candidates placed? What is the percentage? And over a period of time, how the institute is performing. So that we are now in a position to overcome this challenge that the poor children from the hinterland, having no background of the coastline and understanding of what actually the sea means, in search of a glorious career on board ship, sell their, the families, they sell their lands and spend a lot of money and unfortunately end up not getting the employment as they desire. Slowly we are overcoming that situation and we are seeing a lot of progress on that. Today, no seafarer can leave Indian shores if he does not have an official letter of appointment by RPSL. RPSL is a registered shipping personnel providing company registered with the Government of India. So under the MEA's initiative of Surakshit Jao, Prashikshit Jao, they have ensured that anybody who is leaving Indian shores to go on board a ship has an official appointment later to go on board. There are today about 200 Indian seafarers languishing in various jails abroad. Either those seafarers are abandoned by the ship owners, or the ships are arrested by the flag state or the port state, or these seafarers are treated or labeled as criminals because the ships were carrying contraband or arms, etc. This again is a challenge today. Unfortunately, this came to our notice only when the e-migrant came into being, and then we started finding out where are these people, etc. Till then, there was no information about them. Now, unfortunately, we do not have SOPs laid down to get those people back. We don't have skills available in the country who can actually fight the case for them. For 12 seafarers which were recently released by the Nigerian authorities, we had to engage a barrister from London to fight their case. So, all this is actually shipping. It's not just the ship, the bottoms, and the cargo loading and unloading. I mean, all of this makes the country's shipping sector more vibrant and more participative and contributing. Although we are the third largest provider of the seafarers to the world, after Philippines and China, we do not have any say at IMO. International Maritime Organization is the body, which is United Nations body, looking after all the initiatives related to shipping. The result of that, because we don't have a permanent representative at IMO, like we have one in Geneva, or we have in United Nations, but we don't have a permanent representative in London at IMO. The result of that is there are various technological advantages or recommendations, suggestions, or the IMO protocols that are coming into being are not really in favor of our shipping sector. And therefore, I personally have been strongly requesting the government that we must have a permanent representative in London attending these conferences, meetings of IMO, because suddenly the lobbies there come up with some equipment or a protocol talking about a particular technology, and then our ships have to have those equipments on board. Now, those equipments are not manufactured here. Those equipments are manufactured by some companies elsewhere in the world. And suddenly you have $100,000 or $150,000 to be spent on having that particular equipment on board. And we have no option but to accept that, because we were not there when this was being discussed. We have no understanding of what can be an alternative technology to this from our standpoint. We have so many good technocrats in the country, so many good companies in the country who can probably provide the alternate technological solutions to those challenges that are there for the shipping industry, but we don't have anyone because we don't know. And as I said, at times we are there in the IMO General Assembly at the number 25, 26. So by the time the first 10, 15 people have spoken, there is very little interest amongst the other members to really look at what India is trying to say. These are some of the issues that I thought are essential for us to understand when we say we want to shape the shipping industry. HRA, the high-risk area notification was another area where India suffered a lot. We paid almost to the tune of $1 billion worth insurance premium every year when Indian Navy had four ships deployed in the Gulf of Aden and in the Indian Ocean, just to ensure there is no piracy incident, there is no such thing that happens there. And while Indian Navy was busy providing protection to all the ships, not only Indian ships, but all the ships that were passing through the Indian Ocean, the Indian consumer, common consumer, because when you pay this $1 billion insurance for the ships calling at Indian port, it is you and me who was paying that insurance premium, because the shipping lines were recovering it from the consumer. So we had to then argue, make a claim and a presentation at IMO, and IMO said nobody, India never came to us saying that why this is being levied on us. And then they put us to the insurance cartel that was there in New York, and then we had to fight it out. And thanks to MRCC at Mumbai, which gave a detailed account of which ship, what time, how it happened. And then all of this, why I'm giving you little detail is probably for a common man, these things are not really known. Every time there used to be an effort to register an incident in Indian waters to say that, see, Indian waters are not safe. Something or the other happens. And there were two, three such incidences that these insurance companies kept on mentioning or repeating again and again at international forums. And then MRCC gave us a complete information detail that the incidents actually happened in Seychelles water, and then the ship moved into India, and the captain sends the message when he enters the Indian waters. He's not sending a message when he's in Seychelles water, but he's sending a message, and that too he's not sending it to the flag state control. He's not sending it to the Indian agency. He's sending it directly to London, saying that, see, these incidents is happening in Indian waters, and therefore Indian waters are not safe. You know, so why I'm giving, I mean, all this is basically, I thought, I mean, we must understand that there is opportunity, there is involvement and need for professionals to get into Indian shipping related to all these aspects. Be it training, be it maritime law, again, a sector where we've hardly any expertise available in India on maritime law. Not many law colleges teach them. Again, security, there's another thing which is opening up is the floating armory, wherein you have these. And then, see, the funniest part is all these floating armories were registered in UK. Okay, and they were operating in Indian Ocean. Admiral sitting here, and he was probably there at the helm when all of this was happening. So these are some of the things I thought I'll share with you. Of course, our fleet is, I mean, at least a couple of years ago, the fleet was youngest. I mean, the fleet that we own was youngest. But then there are other regulations which are coming in, which probably Captain Nafde will deal, double hull tankers, the ships which are beyond 25 years of age will not be permitted henceforth, etc. All of that is something which will lead to replacing some of our old fleets, some of the sectors where India should have its own fleet because it is in strategic interest, and which we don't have, say for example, container shipping. The ship that we have is only 4,000 ton TEU ship, which Shipping Corporation of India owns. Now we do a lot of trade with Europe. I mean, our largest trading partner is Europe, but then none of our ships call European ports. I mean, the Shipping Corporation of India ship does not go far into the European territory. We go up to Felixstowe and come back. Now, Felixstowe is not the place where we do trade. We do trade with Germany, we do trade with Rotterdam and other places, Hamburg, but our ships cannot go there. Now, this is something which, I mean, we will have to really work on, and as entrepreneurs, as policymakers, or the Chamber of Commerce that influences the Government of India or the state government's thought process, I think it is necessary that we all look into these aspects and take the necessary steps.